Joe, you were out looking for a particular kind of wildlife yesterday, and you said you were having a hard time.
I was. Well, I invited Patrice and I go way back.
Okay, first of all, tell everybody who we have here.
This is Patrice Peterson Keys. Mm-hmm. I call her Patty. We're grown-ups now, so she's got a little more formal name, but she's with the Polk County Conservation Board, and we go way back to Kids Club and did all kinds of fun vignettes and things together. So if I need anything, nature-related or that, she's my go-to girl.
But anyway, that works. Happy to she's do from that. The Polk County Conservation Board, and you were out looking for butterflies yesterday.
I was out
yesterday.
Looking for butterflies.
You had that little net like that. I could just see you running around with a little net like this trying to catch butterflies.
Yes, and I had my little one trying to help me. I said, we need to catch some monarchs. And she was like, how many do we need to get? And I said, just one. If we could just get one. We looked every, but you know, as you had mentioned, it's the like hot, sunny days, and that is not what it was yesterday. Right. So I didn't have any luck catching a live one, but I did have a couple of preserved ones. So we can kind of refer
pining.
To these as well.
Okay.
But we have you in today because monarch tagging is a big thing for the month of September. Mm-hmm. And I don't know that a lot of people are familiar with that. We talked a lot about, I know Lou's tried to grow, 10 acres of milkweed at his house to help the effort.
It hasn't started yet, though, but the seeds are in the ground.
Good for you. Very good.
We do have a couple of really good established, milkweed clusters, and those are ready to go. So they're waiting for monarchs to come and feed on them. Are they going to come back through this area?
Yes. Yep. So, of course, we've had monarchs all year round.
Okay.
When we start seeing the large amounts is going to be here in the next couple of weeks.
All right.
Because what we're going to be seeing is that the monarchs are going to be passing through on their way to the migration grounds in Mexico. So we're going to be seeing really the whole I-35 corridor is a travel path.
All right. Now, is this when they will be stopping at the milkweed plants that are growing in the ditches, or are they already had their fill?
Right. So the milkweed is actually the host plant for the larva.
For the larva.
Right.
Okay.
For the larva. Now, that doesn't mean that the adults might be sipping on the nectar of the flowers.
Okay.
But, yep, the milkweed is the actual essential key for monarchs in general, because that's the only plant that the milkweed larva will actually eat, that the monarch larva will actually eat. And so that's why we keep talking about milkweed, milkweed, milkweed.
Now, are you seeing a difference that is made? Because I know I've let a lot of the milkweed just go in my yard. It comes up in the most inconvenient places, but I let it go. And are you noticing, and I think more people are doing the same or making the effort to plant it.
Certainly,
are we noticing a difference in the population?
I think just in general, just me, making general observations, we can't really get a good population count. The population count actually happens in Mexico. That's where they look at and actually assess, people actually go out and count, the acreage of monarchs down there. So we can't really get a good assessment besides just a visual, hey, I think I'm seeing more type thing during the summer.
Now, there's been a major decline in the monarch population, hasn't there?
Right, yeah. And that has to do with lots of different factors. Of course, during one season, we've got multiple generations happening of monarchs. It's not just a, one generation thing or anything like that. So, if we just even look around, until recently when people start talking about milkweed and planting milkweeds and just native flowers and things like that, look around and pretty much our landscape is fairly sterile, where we used to have, weedy cornfields and weedy bean fields and roadside ditches. We've tidied things up a lot, and that tidying of things gives less milkweed and less habitat than for the monarchs, what they need.
And a follow-up what Michelle said, too, about the milkweed popping up in other places, I have noticed more and more in the ditches, on the side of the roadways, the milkweed plants, just flourishing.
Right.
And you hadn't seen that in the past 3-4 years.
Yeah, and that's just about education. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to tell people how important it actually is. We don't have to mow ditches. My ditch happens to be very messy. It has lots of milkweed in it. I have a small prairie planting in my front yard, too. Again, those things are there for not only the monarchs, but other essential pollinators as well.
Talk about the lifestyle of, so the monarchs that are leaving here, we have a great map that we can show that shows the migration path where they and heading down to Mexico.
That's actually the return. That one is the return.
Okay,
there we go. Yeah. So basically we've got all the monarchs that are east of the Rocky Mountains are all heading down to Mexico. I mean, how they know to get there, it's still kind of this huge mystery.
I think they have a timeshare. Mexico.
Maybe.
When they travel, that then that they come back. Is it that? So how long can it does a monarch live, and how many of those trips can they take?
They don't make a round trip.
Oh, they don't?
Sorry.
They don't make a round trip.
Okay. I thought they did.
No round trips being
okay,
made.
Okay,
so
is it
a tag team effort then? Is that basically what it is?
Yeah, yeah, okay. Exactly. So the monarchs that are starting to emerge now, so out of the chrysalis, that we're going to be seeing that those are going to be the ones that are going to be starting to make their way down to Mexico. So something in them, again, we don't know all the science behind it, says, okay, rather than mating and laying eggs, nope, we're gonna wait on that, and instead we're gonna go to Mexico. So our monarchs as far north as Canada are going to be heading down to Mexico and making up to a 3,000-mile journey.
That was my next question.
Yes.
How far do some
yes.
of them travel? 3,000 miles.
3,000 miles. And
wow.
It wasn't until we started tagging them that, you know, kind of could start to gather some of this data and to figure out, okay, you know, how, you know, what's percentage, things like that. So, again, it's all about getting good science and getting good numbers to make good decisions,
now,
too.
Tagging them. Okay, so if we had say we wanted to tag Michelle's because it's slow and tomorrow. Morning, so it's not moving around much.
Right.
Okay, so it's a little easier to handle.
Right.
Okay, so how would you tag a monarch like that?
Okay, so of course we have to get some scientific data first, and so this is all through the University of Kansas.
Show one of the
yeah,
tags
yeah. So
here.
There's that's the size of the tags. They can't be very large, and there's just some very small amount of information on there, but each monarch that gets tagged has a unique number associated with it, so that way it can be tracked.
Mm-hmm.
And so after it's tagged, we have to do some data collection as far as the date. We also have to know if your monarch is a male or a female.
Really?
Oh, okay. Now, so that matters in your
yes.
track and how you
right, okay. right in your data collection.
So how do you tell
if it's a male or a female?
All right. So your monarch there, Michelle, happens to be a female.
Okay.
All right. And how we tell that? I think we maybe got
and
another.
She can tell that from 6 feet away.
Yes, it could. Yeah.
You're not even looking at its body. How do you know?
Lou flipped it over.
Tried to squint and it didn't really help.
No.
So what are you looking for then?
We're actually looking for two small dots on the bottom of the lower wings. So monarchs have got four wings, okay? And so on the lower wings, they would have two small black dots. And I think I've got, and that one does not. And there's a female, so they're showing the female. And also the little black lines on their wings are kind of the veins are a little bit thicker on the female. So this what we're seeing right now is a female.
Okay.
And then our other one, hopefully we can get to that one, is gonna be a male. And we'll see, do we have another graphic of the male, maybe?
Okay, what's
not, otherwise I've got a picture too. But then we can see where the black dots would
show
be.
Show the picture here, hold the picture up here. I wanna see what the boy looks like.
Okay, so the boy is going to be, so there's the two black dots right there.
Yes.
So there isn't great, but too small, and then those veins are gonna be much thinner.
Okay, here, just hold the camera here like this. Here.
Yeah.
Here we go. Now, where are the dots at?
The dots are right down here.
Oh, those there. Okay.
Those are the dots of the male.
All right.
Oh, interesting.
Yes.
So now, the purpose of tagging is to get more information about the monarchs, and I know you guys, there's a lot of events that are going to be going on.
Yeah.
You guys are having one in September the 8th. What can you do this at home? Like, can we capture the butterflies we have in our yard and tag them ourselves and take part in this, or do you need to be part of somebody that's kind of a
anyone can actually order tags?
Okay.
There's a small fee for them because of course they have to do all the processing of the data and everything. So the general public can order their own tags if they think that they're passionate about it and want to. Hey, this is something I want to do with my family. Be a citizen scientist, because that's really what you're doing.
Right.
Is they can order their own tags and do it at home. Otherwise, they can join in some of our events. We have some things. We're also the zoo. The Blank Park Zoo has a great program
in
September.
Plant, Grow, Fly.
Very good. And they're having a large special event too that we'll be a part of, and we'll actually be tagging some monarchs at that event too.
Oh, great.
Yeah, we'll talk to Jess about that. She'll come
and
mention that when she comes in a little bit late as we get closer.
We're partners with them on the whole monarch
They
venture.
Are really behind this whole monarch thing, aren't they?
Yeah.
They're making a big difference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I've noticed in my own yard that I see a lot more of them flying around this year. So whatever we can do in our own backyards, of course, that's a great place to start. And if you want to learn more about monarch tagging, and you guys are a great source for that for your September 8th event. So thank you for coming in and sharing your expertise with us. Great stuff as always.
Yeah. All right. Now, people want to get more information about all this. What's the best website to go to?
Yeah, they can go to leadingyououtdoors.org is our website.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Find out lots of great events and ideas on how to get outside and enjoy yourself.
And, yes. Yeah. And on weather like today, we all want to do that.
That's right. Thank you so much
Thank
for coming
you for
in.
Coming.
Yeah, you're welcome.
All right. It is 8:22, and we will be right back. This is CW Iowa Live.